started painting when I was 17. I wasn't prepared for that. I thought at 17 that I was going to be a writer. We had moved to New York, from New York to Paris just for the year, and the urge to make paintings just took over me. It wasn't a complete bolt from the blue because my father was a painter and my mother was a writer, so it was not a complete surprise, but I had no expectation that I would get so interested in something so foreign from writing. And perhaps it was the variety of things that were available at the Louvre. I would just go looking around and seeing the variety of subjects and styles that were there to be looked at. And my first paintings were abstract, and they were just color notes, and I wanted to see how the different colors would look one against the other. And there was a formal quality to it as well. They had their own shapes, but they weren't really about anything, although they did sort of give me feelings. These different configurations of colors and forms evoked some kind of feeling. And I was very obsessed by it. And I felt that it was an urgently important thing that I get these pictures down on paper. And I was painting, I was buying oil paint and making things on paper. Then I came back from Paris to New York and enrolled in college, and quickly realized that doing art as a major was kind of a dumb idea, because doing art wasn't really what they did in regular liberal arts college. So I studied art history, much of which was not news to me when I got to college, and I also started doing philosophy. And then after 2 years, I took a year off and went to an art school, the New York Studio School. And at the studio school, they were very involved in modernism, not postmodernism, but modernism. And there was a great impetus for me to do something new. And I thought what I was doing was new enough, because it was what I wanted to do. And they were pushing, particularly, they were pushing Giacometti and de Kooning and to some extent Diebenkorn. And these are great artists, and I have the highest regard for them now. But I felt that there was something kind of fraudulent about taking on the clothing of a deceased master without having an idea of how I got there. And after a couple more semesters at the studio school, I spent a summer in Northampton with some friends who were all in college there. And I suddenly found myself confronted with landscape. And down below the Smith College campus, there was a bend in the river in the Oxbow, and I found myself completely and utterly unprepared for how to represent anything that I saw there. Water, trees, leaves, bark, any of it. So this was a big wake-up call. And then I came back to Rhode Island, where my parents were then living, and I started with my old abstract ways, and I had an epiphany on a hot summer day, and the epiphany was that no one was ever going to know or care if I changed this blotch of yellow to another part of the picture, or changed the color, or changed anything about it. It was the arbitrariness of it was scary. Not just scary, but arbitrary. Who wants arbitrary? So I realized that for a picture, a painting to have meaning, there has to be some mutually agreed subject, an agreement between the person who will look at it and the person who is making it. And the third leg of the equation is the subject. So it doesn't have to be down to the last detail of truth, but you have to have some kind of third, some intervening thing about which we're talking. So from that I realized that I had not learned a whole lot at the New York Studio School and made it my business to learn how to represent or represent things that could be seen in ordinary life. I then went back to college, finished college, and took a job at, wasn't a job, it was a course operated by Sotheby's in London. And I learned a great deal about styles there, not only about paintings, but about decorative arts and furniture and so forth. It was a truly art historical course. From there, I got a job at Sotheby's in New York. It was a building called PB84. They were selling less valuable things. But it was very interesting. I learned about thousands of secondary artists that you would never hear a word about in any art history course. And it was fascinating. It was just a lovely first job. And I stayed there for 6 years. Then went on, took another job in the auction business. Doyle Galleries, and then I became a curator for a well-known American art collector. And then realized that I wasn't getting where I wanted to be. And if I didn't just start painting, it was time to start. So, not that I haven't been painting all along, I have, but now I concluded that you can't do two things at once and do them well. So I gave up every side of the art business and painted full time. And it was a learning curve because of the lack of real instruction in the art of painting, which I view as a language which has its own grammar and vocabulary. And so I spent a few years learning how to do these things, much of which I had learned from very direct contact with 19th century painters. And I had always thought that the modernist revolution, now over 100 years old, left a great deal of very worthy things left on the table. And has never been my intention to redo 19th century or earlier painting, but it has always been my intention to find to create complete mastery of the vocabulary of line and color. I should say the vocabulary and grammar of line and color. I think only now am I getting where I had hoped to be, and I'm thinking that now I'm only really getting there, as they say. Part of it is about finding new things that are worth painting. I don't want to be painting hackneyed subjects like bread, cheese, and wine. On the other hand, I do love landscape, but really it's all about light. The landscape can be great, but if the light isn't interesting, then neither is the painting. So light has been my primary focus in landscape. The way I paint is I go outside and I look for something interesting to paint, and I make a sketch. It's usually not more than 12 by 16 inches and often less big than that, often smaller than that. And the purpose of that is to note the general color characteristics and the light characteristics. This is, after all, going to be the motivation for doing the painting at all. So I come back with a sketch, an oil sketch. I'm not afraid of taking a photograph of it with me, particularly if there are details that I do not want to waste time on when I'm there in person. And that might include architectural details, mullions on windows, things like that, which are very taxing in person, particularly with the wind and the bugs and so forth. All of that is available to me by photography, but the main thing is to never trust the photo in itself. You've got to trust the sketch you bring with you. One thing that I've noticed about photography is far away things have a way of condensing. they also have a way of favoring either the light condition or the ground condition, but never both. So all of these things are things you need to watch out for photography. And photography makes its own decisions about, which are not the main decisions you would make or I would make. And to use a photo for your for the basis of your painting is to trust a machine which has been called the one-eyed liar. In the winters, I have a whole stack of these oil sketches, and I kind of run through them from in a serial way as to which ones I want to tackle first. And I might then make a second iteration of the field sketch, and then a final sketch. It depends on the scale in which I'm trying to work. Another thing which I've learned to like is interiors. When I can find an interesting one, to find an interesting interior these days is harder and harder. You find an awful lot of IKEA furniture that I don't want to make a picture of. Again, light is a huge factor, but just charm and interest that an interior should have. Something should say something about who's in there. It first and foremost should be a painting of a place you'd like to be yourself, at least to look at, if not to live in it. And the objects in it make a big difference in what you're ultimately saying about someone's house. And the third thing, to become a bigger part of my work is interior. It's the still life, both of animate and inanimate things. You can see here, oh, I guess, sorry, you can't see there. I did a lot of flowers starting about 4 years ago. One year when the weather was impossible, I just started in on the flowers. And if you really bear down on these objects, they become very fascinating to watch, to paint in their own right. And then there's another thing that I've made a bit of a specialty of, which is enamel cups. And I got started on the enamel cups here in Maine between sessions of these field sketches. I would, just to sort of shake off the concentration of doing a sketch outside, I'd come into the nearest town and go look for these little enamel cups, which somehow struck me as very poignant and and wanted to know, what is that history? Whose cup was this? And before I knew it, I had a fairly substantial collection of them. There's a lot of variety to them in their shapes and colors. And I had so many that I just started piling them up. And I got more and more baroque with my treatment of these things, and I make some of them. There's something kind of very historical about them, and also kind of slightly sad and sometimes slightly menacing. And basically, if you look things hard enough, you're going to find feeling in them. And that brings me to another mantra of mine, a throwaway sentence allegedly uttered by Henry James, in which he says, in the arts, feeling is meaning. And I think it's extremely useful mantra, because it takes you out of the realm of fact. Not that I'm not interested in fact, I am, but there's not really any point in a work of art unless it is imbued with and or carries the feeling. So the arts are really in the realm of emotion. There is another realm called science, and there are other realms as well. But any arts, whether it's painting,